Let me record this. Perfect. We need a software testing knowledge over it. And the other thing is, this would become a mandatory, or this is a big mandatory in order to excel our career as an ETL testing. So we need to have a knowledge over SQLs. I mean, at least a knowledge on any of the database. I would not say that you should have Oracle or SQL Server or Teradata or DB2. Any of the databases, a knowledge over writing the SQL queries. And I don't want you to be writing all the programmable queries like PLSQL, procedural standards or functions or triggers or commits. But if you are good till joins and subqueries, right, you can make your career. This is all what we need as part of our ETL testing. So what would I suggest? Please go through your SQL commands, because I'm not going to discuss any SQL commands here. We are just mainly focusing on ETL testing here. But after this training, you will definitely need the SQL things to be brushed up. The reason why I say SQL things needs to be brushed up. The first thing is, when you appear for the ETL testing interview, they would ask you to write SQLs. They will be asking you the questions over SQL queries. Okay, they would ask you the questions regarding the join. They would ask you the questions regarding the analytical functions, aggregate functions, everything. So they would ask till your subqueries. Some people may touch views. Views are nothing but, again, your queries that are written. It's just a creation of your virtual table. So I would say, please brush up your SQL skills, all right, to make your career as an ETL test engineer. So once you have this software testing skills along with the SQL skills, SQL writing skills, then you are good to make your career as an ETL test engineer. So these are the prerequisite things that is required for every person to make a career as ETL testing. Okay, so these stands as a prerequisites. So I would recommend everyone to please go through the SQL basics again once the class is done, or you can even make your at your comfortable times. All right, so what is ETL testing? Let's jump into the main part. All right, so ETL testing, you everyone know, because you're already working on testing domain, so you know what do you mean by testing. So we'll concentrate on the topic called as an ETL. So what is ETL? Everyone say this is an extraction, right, transformation and loading process. Everyone can say expansion. But why extraction? Why transformation? Why loading? Why is this extraction, transformation and loading has come into picture, come into existence? This is the main important thing one has to understand. Okay, so let me take a particular application. All right, let me take a banking application. Let's say I have a bank called as an ICICI. Okay, every transactions or every action that is happening over this ICICI bank, let's say I have 10 customers who are added up, they are performing some transactions. All right. Or they are depositing some amount, they are withdrawing some amount. The 10 customers, few of them are active customers, few of them are inactive customers. And people are accessing this site over online. Alright. So where is the data coming from for this particular application? To this entire application, you have a backend system called as your database. Right. It's just like our human brain. If I ask you to drive from high-tech city to some other place, you will drive it because you know the route for it. So your brain is acting as a driver for you to make you move from one particular place to another particular place. Likewise, any web application or any application that is storing the data and that is also retrieving the data will have their backend configured with a database. Now, what is this particular database? This database will have all the data, all the customer related data, payments related data, right? Customer, what is the status related data, banks related data, everything would be maintained within this. Every kind of information would be maintained within this. Okay, so every web application or every application has got its backend media as a database. Now, how is the data organized within the database? Within the database, the data is organized in the form of your rows and columns, and that in tables. There comes a particular point here. All the databases are in normalized form. All the databases are in normalized form. So what do I mean by normalized form? It will not maintain any duplicate data. Alright, no duplicate data is maintained within the databases. Now, why am I talking about this normalization? Why am I talking about this particular duplicate data? How is this related to ETL? Why Satish is giving all these things? Okay, let's go into an example. Everyone might have played with this particular table, the simple table EMP. Right. Now, I have a column called as employee number, which is standing as a primary key. E-name, job and salary. I'm figuring out or I'm picking up only few columns from that particular table so as to demonstrate or to give you a basic idea as what kind of a data that the database would store. Okay. Now, let's say the employee ID is 3484, all right, Durga, okay, and he is working as a QA lead, right, his salary is as 75,000. I have another employee, 3485, Satish, who is working as a QA engineer. And his salary is somewhere around 35,000. Okay. Now, I'm figuring out this particular data for the year 2014. Okay. Whatever the data that we have within this particular EMP table, the data belongs to the year 2014. Now, in the 2015 year, the appraisal system has come into picture. So, as a result, the organization has decided that Durga should be given a hike of 8,000 and Satish has got a designation change. Right. He is going to be provided from, he is going to be promoted from QA to senior QA engineer. Okay. And his salary is incremented by 7,500. Now, how can I get this particular data affected onto that particular table or within that particular table? What am I supposed to do? What am I supposed to do in order to have this particular data getting affected onto this particular tables? What am I supposed to do? I have to write a query called as an update. Right. I have to write a query called as an update. Update EMP. Set salary equal to salary plus 8,000, where EMP number is equal to 3484. When I execute this part of the query, I would see the salary getting affected here. Likewise, I have to also write a query to update the job of Satish. Job is equal to senior QA, comma, salary equal to salary plus 7,500. And who should be getting this? This should be applied to the employee number called as 3485. Now, when I execute these two queries, what will happen to my data? My data will be in this way now. This would be 83,000. All right. This would be senior QA and this would be 42,500. Clear? All right. Now, like this, I have, let's say, 10,000 employees within my EMP table. Now, there has come a question from the management after a course of time. Let's say, after giving the appraisal of 6 months, after later on 6 months duration, the questions has come into picture from the management. Figure out the employees who are given a hike of 5,000 with a 5,000 or more with a designation change. With a designation change. Now, can I get this particular answer? Can I get the answer for this particular part of question? Can I get this answer from that particular table?
Yes.
How?
The Satish.
How you are giving the answer as Satish? What is helping you in order to give that particular answer?
His designations change to QA to senior QA.
How are you figuring it out? Now, what happened here? When I updated this particular data, I see this particular data in the EMP table. Do I have any record stating that Satish was earlier as QA? Do you see that information in the EMP table now?
No.
No. So how can we give? Can we give that particular information here? I cannot. Because I don't have any previous instance of the employees. I don't have what was the previous designation of Durga. I don't have what was the previous designation of Satish. Because what happened here? Now, I have made an update to this particular tables. As I made an update to this particular tables, what happened? I lost my previous data. Right. What do I mean by update? Update is nothing but overwriting the data. Right. Update is nothing but overwriting the data. As I overwrite, I will lose my previous data. Now, instead of this update, if I try to insert the data, insert into EMP values, again I'm trying to insert 3484 Durga. All right. QA lead, okay, and 83,000. If I try to execute this part of the query, what happens? I would get an error. If I execute that part of the query instead of updating this particular table, if I say I have to insert the data into that particular EMP table, then I would get an error. The error would be unique constraint violated. Why am I getting this particular unique constraint violated? Because of this particular primary key set on this particular employee table. So what is a primary key? A primary key is a column which will not hold any duplicate values. That means I cannot hold a data like another record for 3484, okay, with the same employee number. I cannot hold a record of 3484 again. You see this? Again, I'm trying to insert that particular data into this particular EMP table. As a result, I get this particular error message, unique constraint violated. So I'll not be able to insert the data. So the option, the only option that I have is update. So if I update, what happens? It will erase the old history, or it will erase the old data, and it would override the new data. So as I override the new data, what is happening? I'm losing the history. I'm losing the history. Now, why am I talking about this particular history? Why am I stressing on this? Right. So this is the one. What is this particular question all about? The question is about figuring out those employees who were given a hike of 5,000 or more and with a designation change. Now, what am I trying to do with this particular question? I may be analyzing the data. Right. I may be analyzing the data, or the higher management may want to analyze the data. Right. And that is the reason why you are posted with this particular question. Very simple. Let's say you have started a business. Okay. The business was started in the year 2013. And you proceeded, or you progressed to year 2014, and you progressed to year 2015. When you have progressed from 2013 to 2014, you would do an analysis. You would cross-check back, go to the back year, one step back, and see which are the months which yielded good profits to you. Right, what you have done in order to get that particular profits. So why do you analyze your historical data? To make an action over your current situation on the year 2014. Okay, so in the year 2013, there was these particular periods where I had certain losses. So what am I supposed to do in order to encounter profits, or in order to make profits during the losses region, during the loss period, what am I supposed to do? Likewise, when I progressed my business into the year 2015, what I would do? I would check, or I would analyze the year 2014. Okay, what has happened in the year 2014? How was the progress? Right. So where am I going losses? Where am I getting profits? What am I supposed to do in order to ensure that these losses are converted into profits? So what am I trying to do? I'm checking the previous data, the historical data. Why am I checking the previous historical data? To make a decision over the current situation. And why is this use going, or how is this going to benefit me? It is going to benefit me in order to progress in the business. In order to progress in the business. Another very simple instance is our classes. I really don't know whether you have inquired online or somewhere. Like, let's say if DWBI Adda, right, is coming up for an ETL testing course. Now you are investing some amount into it. So what would you do? You may check whether the course that is given by the DWBI Adda is competitive or not, whether the person who is delivering this particular content is delivering, or whether he has got good set of ratings or good set of comments or not. You may do such an a research on it, and based on that you may go with the pricing and you may go with the purchasing of a certain courses. Right, so what are you trying to do? You're trying to check with the previous people experience. Based on that you are progressing whether to opt or not. Right, so all the time what is helping you? Your previous history is helping you in order to take a decision on the current situation, which will help you to make your things perfect. Okay. Now, the disadvantage of your database is all the databases are in normalized form now. All the databases, all the relational databases are in normalized form. As a result, I will not be able to maintain historical data. So as a result, if I don't maintain historical data, my analysis is going to get affected. Right? Is going to get affected. Right? So why my analysis is required? To take the decisions. Right, if I'm able to know, if I'm able to do certain analysis, then I would take a decision, okay, whether to follow the same process or come up with a new set of approach. All right, so I would be able to take a decisions on doing certain analysis, and this is not possible with the help of a database, and this has laid the path for the data warehouse. So what is a data warehouse? It is a database concept, and please remove this particular thinking called as database. Data warehouse is a separate software. Database, data warehouse is not at all a separate software. It is a concept that is driven from your database. It's an extended concept of your database, you can say. Okay, it's a concept that is being extended from database. Now, what is data warehouse going to do? What is database could not do? What database could not do? It could not maintain the historical data out there, right? I lost the history of Durga. His old salary was 75,000. As a result of this particular update, I see that the salary is as 83,000 and not 75,000. Okay, I lost the history out there. Likewise for Satish, I lost the history. I didn't see, or I'm not able to see his previous job, right, and his previous salary. So that was the thing. That was the thing that is missing. So a data warehouse is a database concept which maintains the current and historical data. Why this current and historical data is necessary? Which is useful for your business analysis and decision making. This is the main reason why a data warehouse has come into picture. Alright, which is going to maintain your current and historical data, which is useful for your business analysis and decision making. This is the prime reason for the data warehouse existence. Now, let's take the same situation and understand how a data warehouse is going to do. Now, this is our source table, or this is our database table, right? Database table. Okay. Likewise, I'm going to create another table. Let's say I'm trying to maintain my warehouse table. Data warehouse table. Okay, the important thing that happens when constructing the data warehouse table is, when constructing the data warehouse table, source primary key will not be the primary key of warehouse table. So when I say warehouse table, it means your data warehouse table. So what is your primary key in case of my source? When I say source, the place where you are getting the data from. So where am I getting the data? From where am I going to get the data? I'm going to get the data from my database table. So the database will become my source. Okay. Here, in case of my source, what is the column that is standing as a primary key? It is the EMP number which is standing as the primary key. Now, when constructing a warehouse, you would see that EMP number will be as a normal key. It will not be the primary key. And in a particular table, in order to retrieve the data, in order to have the faster retrieval process, and also to have a relationship maintained to the other tables, you need to have a primary key set. So within your data warehouse table, a separate primary key is going to be maintained. And that is nothing but called as surrogate key. Surrogate key will be the primary key of your target table. When I say target, the destination, where is my data is going to get loaded? Into my data warehouse table. So this is my destination. So here I'm going to maintain a surrogate key, which would be acting as my primary key for my warehouse table. So what would be the nature of this particular key? It would be an auto incrementing in nature. Okay.
Sir, could you please explain about data warehousing once, just a last minute.
Sorry, Swami, I didn't get your question.
Just could you please repeat about the data warehouse concept once?
You want me to explain the data warehouse concept again?
Yeah.
Okay. Where did I go? Okay, you want me to explain with the same set of example again?
Yeah, this is.
Yeah.
I lost in between actually. But why did we introduce the database concept? From there I lost it. I couldn't understand.
Okay, this one?
There.
All right. So, no problem. I'll explain you through an example. That way you can better understand it. Okay, Swami?
Sure, thank you.
Yep, thanks, man. All right. Fine. So I'm trying to maintain. So the reason, check it out. How is my warehouse table, the column name that you see here? I'm saying that I have a surrogate key, and the surrogate key, let's say, SD underscore EMP. This would be standing as my primary key. Likewise, I will be having all the columns of my target table. All right. I'll not go with any audit columns. For now, I'll keep it as it is. Okay. Now, let's take the situation here. Okay. Initially, what I had in the database table, within the database table, I have the data in this way. I have the data corresponding to Durga and Satish as QA lead and QA and 75,000 and 35,000. Now, it is my responsibility to maintain the warehouse table. So when I say I have to maintain the warehouse table, what needs to be done? The data from database has to be moved onto my warehouse table. So here, this particular data would get loaded into the target table now. I would do a mechanism. I would, run a particular job which will load this particular data into my warehouse table. Okay. Now, on loading this, what it does, on loading this, what it's supposed to do, it has to go with a primary key. Let's say surrogate key incrementing. Our nature of surrogate key should start from 1001, and it has to get incremented by 1 for each and every record that gets loaded. Okay, sorry, 3484. Okay, so this is my data. Likewise, I'll be having, because the next set of record would be 1002, and it has to be loaded into my warehouse table. Okay, so I have the data here. So, okay, what happened again? There was an update happened, right? According to the normal situation, there was an update happened. Okay, so with the update, what happened? You see that this is the data for, this is the data for Satish and Durga. So what happened here? The data got changed to 83,000. And this was changed to 42,500. And this is a senior QA. Okay, so whenever you see a change in data, or whenever you get a new set of records into your table, or whenever there is an update happened, now it is our responsibility, or it is the responsibility of pushing this particular data into our warehouse. So what happens now when I execute a particular job which is configured in order to pull this particular data or load it into this? So what happens? My surrogate ID gets incremented, and it would load the data for Durga again. QA lead and 82,000 or 83,000, whatever it is. Likewise, 1004, 3485, Satish, right, senior QA and 42,500. Now here you see, within my warehouse table, what do I have? I have the current data as well as historical data. See, this is my current data, the latest data that I have within my source. And also, I have my historical data, right? I also have my historical data maintained within my warehouse table. So what is a data warehouse here? It is a database concept which maintains the current and historical data. Right, it should maintain your current and historical data. So what is it for? It has to analyze. So what is my analysis question here? See, figure out the employees who are given a hike of 5,000 or more with a designation change. Yes, can I give that particular answer here now? Can I get the answer on looking at the data warehouse table now?
Yeah, we can get it.
Right, I can get that particular information. I can see that I can write a small query on this particular table, and I can get that particular information. But can I get the same information from this particular table, database table? Can I get that? I cannot, because I don't have any history over there. But within my warehouse, I do have the history and I do have the current data. So I have both the things here. So with the help of both the things, I can give the analysis. I can give the answer to that particular analytical question. And based on that, I can take my decisions. And this is what a data warehouse is. To summarize everything, okay, a data warehouse is one which is going to be useful for your decision-making process. This is the main reason why this is the main reason why data warehouse has come into picture. You have to go with your decisions. Let's say I want to operate my business. If I want to operate my business, I need to have my database. Why I need to have my database for the business? Because I have to store the data here. When I store the data, I can run my business. But in order to make my business effective, I need to analyze the business. Right? I need to analyze the business. So to analyze the business, I cannot go with the database. Why I cannot go with the database? Because my database is not maintaining my historical data. I'll not be able to analyze it. So that is the reason why the database concept has been extended to data warehouse. So what data warehouse is going to do? It is going to maintain my current and historical data. With that, I can analyze the things. I can analyze the things and I can move forward. I can take my decisions whatever the way that I wanted to. Is that clear, the concept of warehouse? Swami, did I clear your question?
Absolutely.
Right? Everyone clear with the point? Why a data warehouse has come into picture?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, my audio connection lost. Just give me a minute, guys. Shweta? Sorry, guys. Yeah, Prem, I think I lost your question, please. Can you come again?
No. This is awesome.
Okay. Yes, Swami, you are asking any question?
Yeah, I was asking one actually basic question, Durga. So I understood about the database table, but what about the data warehouse table? Who generally creates that and who maintains it?
Okay, you are talking about the construction of this warehouse table. Who is going to create this particular table? Who is going to do all these things, right?
Exactly.
Simple. Yeah. The database tables, even this is created by a person called as your data modeler. They are the one who is going to design our database. The same persons are the one who is going to design the data warehouse tables. You'll be having a data modeler team who would be designing that, would be constructing all the tables that is necessary for our warehouse builder. Because if I talk about this thing, right, see this. If I say that this is my warehouse database, let's say this is my Oracle system. So within my Oracle system, if I want to operate my business, right, if I want to run my business, so what would I do? I need tables within which my data is going to get stored, right? So in order to have this particular tables created and the relationship getting established between them, I need the help of a person called as data modeler. You have a modeling team, data modeling team. They does this particular activity. The same is the case. Now, did I say data warehouse is a separate software? No. What did I say? I said this is an extension of your database. So that means, again, this would be a flavor of my Oracle, if I'm talking about in Oracle, but a larger in size than my database. Why it will be larger in size? Because this is going to have current and historical data. Even within this warehouse, what am I going to do? I'm going to maintain the data in the form of tables. So if I have to maintain the data in the form of tables, again, I have the requirement of a data modeler, the same data modeler who would be creating my tables. You may have one among the same team or a different person from a different team. But definitely, it is the data modeler activity who would be constructing the tables for us. Clear, Swami?
Yeah, got it. So it's not going to be a tester responsibility, right?
No, it's not at all a tester responsibility. You will be having separate teams, okay? You'll be having a testing team, dev team, and modeling team, DBA team, many teams as we have in the normal web application. But you see a different term here. Now, likewise, it is not the tester responsibility to move the data. It is the responsibility of the developer. So what developer does? Developer will create a mechanism. He would create a job, which is when executed, this would move this particular data and gets loaded into our warehouse. Okay, so it is again not an activity of test engineer. It is the activity of a developer who should create this particular job. Then what testing team does? Testing team should test this particular job, whether the data is properly getting loaded into our warehouse table or not, or whether the data that is being loaded is correct in shape or not. So this is what we do as part of our testing activities in a very nutshell. Clear, Swami?
It's clear.
Yeah. And everyone, any questions so far?
No, it's clear, Durga.
Yeah, thank you. All right. So this is how the data warehouse is constructed, and this is the prime reason for going for moving on to your data warehouse. A database is useful for running your business. You're going to maintain your daily activities. But in order to analyze the business, in order to make a decision supporting system, then we need to go with a data warehouse. And that is the reason why data warehouse is said to be as decision supporting system. Okay, data warehouse is said to be as a DSS system, decision supporting system. All right, so this is on a small table. Okay, this is on a small table to understand the data warehouse. Now, I'm going to give you a live or at least a near to a live situation why or how the data warehouse is going to get built up and what how is the, what do you say, data getting moved from one system to another system and why exactly we go with that particular way. Okay, so to do this, I'll take this particular activity. Okay, now you can talk whatever the explanation that I'm going to give you, it can even help you in explaining your projects as well. Right, now every application that is going to get built is used to serve a particular need. Right, if we have a problem, we are going to come up with the solution, and the solution is in the form of a particular software application, as we have in the in the real world. Today we are meeting through GoToMeeting. The main purpose is to have a web conference. I am in US and you are in Hyderabad or some other part of world, right? You are in some other part of the world, but you want the meeting to be conducted. We want to have a live interaction, and that is being helped by the GoToMeeting. The same is the case in the natural world, or in order to make our decision supporting system, there would be a problem. To solve that particular problem, we are coming up with a solution. Okay. Now, the problem is here. The first problem what I'm going to talk about is Government of India wants to analyze the Government of India wants to analyze the medical shops, right? Medicines sold in medical shops, right? The brands, which is the brand that they are going to sell most in number, this is the main reason that they wanted to analyze. This is the main thing that they wanted to analyze. All right. So in order to analyze this, what they need to have, they need to get the information. Let's say I'm talking about only few stores. Okay. I have an Apollo store. I have a MedPlus. I have Hetero. These are the stores that operate over online and everywhere. So what government has decided, okay, first we'll approach these three stores, then we'll implement our project, we'll extend the project to other particular stores also. So what they have decided, okay, so we will analyze the data from the Apollo store, from the MedPlus, from the Hetero. we would try to get in touch with these three teams and we would ask them to get the to give us the data. Okay, so what they have done, they have made an agreement with Apollo, MedPlus and Hetero. Okay, and the agreement is they have to send the data. Apollo has to send, MedPlus has to send, and Hetero has to send the data in the in any of their form, right, every month. First of every month, we need to get the data. We need to get the data, and this data should be corresponding to the customers related data, the sales related data, the the invoices related data. I mean, the sales and invoices would be in one particular thing. All right, and that too, the medicines that are available. Okay, I mean the procurement related data and everything. So they need all this particular information from each and every store. Right, each and every store of Apollo, MedPlus and Hetero. Okay, so this is the main thing. So as a result, they have made the tie-up with the these three stores. So as a result, what they are supposed to do, they are supposed to send this particular data to them. Let's say this particular project has been started to us, or we have acquired this particular project and we are starting this. Okay, now Apollo is sending their data in the form of a file, and this file is .csv file, because no one wants to give the access to their entire database, right? No one will never give. It's their operational database. No one will give access to that. So what they have done, okay, you have asked me this, okay, what I'll do, I'll generate a file for you, and this particular file will be having all this particular information. Like, I'll be sending you the data in the form of four different files for you. One file is my all the customer related data. One file is for all the medicine procurement related data. One file is for my invoices and everything. One file is for the medicines that are available, or the labbed medicines and everything. Let's say in that way. So they are sending me four different flat files. Okay, Apollo is sending the four different flat files in the form of .csv. Likewise, I have a Metro. The Metro store is also sending the data in the form of a flat file. All right, they are sending the data in .dat file, which is a pipe delimiter. So what do I mean by pipe delimiter? If I have a column like EMP number and ename, if I have a file which is having these two columns, then they are separated by a pipe. If at all I say it's a comma separated fun, I'd be having a comma that is separating the data between both the columns. When I say pipe delimited, I'll be having a delimiter set to as a pipe. Okay, even they are sending in the form of a .dat file, .dat file, that is a pipe delimited one. Likewise, Hetero. Hetero has given an access, right, what they have done. Okay, they are sending the data in the form of view. So what they have created, Hetero has created a view on their database, and they have given us the access over that particular view, not to all the tables. They have just given an access to that particular view, and this is in the Oracle system. Okay, now the thing is, I have three different sources now who are going to vend the data, who are going to send the data to me, but all these three sources are of different nature. One source is sending the file in .csv format. The other source is sending the file in .dat format, which is a pipe delimited one. The other source is given an access to the Oracle table, Oracle view, which is going to vend the data. Now I have to construct my warehouse. Right. So I have to construct my warehouse. So all these particular data, I have to ensure that my warehouse is getting stored over there. So first process, what am I supposed to do? Yes, what I'll say is I have to extract the information. I have to pull the information from all these three particular sources. So what I'll do, I'll lay an extraction process from all these three particular sources. I'll lay an extraction process. I have to pull the data from all these three sources. Okay, so on pulling of all these particular sources, now these sources are of different types. They are of not same type, right? I cannot join the data directly from these three sources. So what am I supposed to do? Okay, I'm getting this particular data from the Apollo. I'm loading them into one of my temporary tables. Let's say I have customer underscore Apollo, right? What else we have? Transactions underscore Apollo, medicines underscore Apollo, and whatever the table is. Likewise, I have customers underscore MedPlus, transaction underscore MedPlus, medicines underscore MedPlus. Likewise, here, customer underscore hetero, transactions underscore hetero, and medicines underscore hetero. I have certain tables. So what am I going to do? I'm going to extract the data from these particular files and gets loaded into these tables, temporary tables, into all these particular temporary tables. Now all these particular tables are in my system. Let's say this is my Oracle system. Okay, all the data is getting loaded into my Oracle system. Now here within my warehouse, I have a single customer table, I have a single transaction table, I have a single medicine table. I have only these three tables. Okay, apart from this, I have another tables like the customer, active customers, customers inactive. Okay, likewise, I have the transactions over credit card, transactions over cash. Also, the main thing is on this particular medicines. All right, medicines underscore different brand, like let's say Ranbaxy, medicines underscore some other vendor, let's say YYY, whatever it is, medicines underscore some other, let's say. So I'm going to categorize all these things. So that means whatever the data that I'm getting here, this has to be transformed now. Isn't it? I have the customer related data coming from three different files. Now what am I supposed to do? I'm supposed to join these three tables and pull out active customers and then load them into this particular table. I have to pull out the inactive customers and I have to load them into this particular table. I have to see the customers and their transaction table. Based on that, I have to load this particular data into this customer transaction table. I have to look at the customers and transaction table, and based on that, I have to load the data into my cash table. Likewise, I have to analyze these medicine tables of these three sources, and from these three sources, the total medicines that were sold as part of Ranbaxy, the total medicines that were sold as part of YYY, the total medicines that were sold as part of ZZZ. So what am I trying to do here? I have 9 files, or whatever the count number of files that we are getting from the source, and they are first extracted from the source systems. On extracting them, what we have done? We have loaded into our temporary tables. So this area is called as our staging area, which will hold the data for temporarily. All right. So this is holding the data temporarily. Now from the staging area, what is happening? We are applying a transformation. A transformation is nothing but a business rule. Okay, what do I mean by business rule? Let me extend this. All right, a transformation is nothing but my business rule. So what do I mean by the business rule here? Let's say I'm getting the data in this way. These are my customer records. Customer name, all right, city and phone number, status. Okay, these are the three column or four columns that I have. Customer name, okay, alongside I created a customer ID. All right, customer ID 1001, it's Durga, right, he's from Herndon. All right, some 1234567890 is his phone number, he's an active one. Likewise, 1002, Satish, right, he is from some other place. Let's say Hyderabad. Alright, he is having another phone number. He is also an active. Let's say another person called as some Prakash. Okay, he is from Vijayawada. Alright, he is having the phone number. And he is inactive. Okay, so this is the data that I have in one of the table. This is the data that I have in one of the table, and the table is let's say this is my table called as customer underscore Apollo. Likewise, I have another table called as customer underscore hetero. Alright, where I have different set of customers. Alright, here 1004. Let's say the hetero has started from 2001. Okay. Swami, let's say Swami, he is from Hyderabad. Okay. And he is active. Inactive. This, let's say these are the two records that I have from the hetero. Likewise, I have another table that is of my MetaPlus. Okay, let me take the other one. I'm taking the other one. I'll change the data here. And the data is in this way. Inactive. So this is my another table called as customer underscore MetaPlus, whatever it is. Alright. Now this is the data that I have in my stage table. Now I have to load the data into my customer table, customer active table. Customer underscore active table, in which the columns are first ID, first name. Okay, now I have phone number. Okay, I have status. Okay, these are the four columns that I have, and the transformation rule is transformation rule. If status is as active, A. If status is as inactive, then I. Okay. If no status, then reject the records. Okay. This is my transformation rule. So what needs to happen when moving the data into my warehouse table? What needs to happen? The developers has to configure the job or create a job which is going to load the data into the table, which joins all the data from all the three sources. It has to pull the data from the Apollo. It has to pull the data from Hetero. It has to pull the data from MetaPlus. On pulling the data, it has to pull only the active records out of it. On pulling the active records, it should load the data corresponding to Durga and phone number, whatever the phone number that he has. It's very big, I'm not writing there. Active. Likewise, Satish, right, whatever the phone number is, active. Likewise, 2001, Swami active. All right. Likewise, that's it. Only these three records should get loaded into your customer underscore active table. So what is happening here? Earlier, we have extracted the data. Prior to this particular thing, what happened? We have extracted the data from all the sources and loaded them into our staging tables. So what is the staging area? Staging area is my temporary tables, temporary area where my data is going to get holded for temporarily. I'm going to tell you what happens next. From the staging area, yes, Swami.
Durga, just have a basic question in between. So how do we extract the data from different sources to the staging table? Is there any specific mechanism is there or no?
See, this is all configured by the team, by the developers team. They will be creating a job. What this job does, let's say I have this particular file, okay? This particular file, what are they trying to do? They are trying to place in SFTP location, okay? Whatever the job that is created by the developer, this job has to go into this particular location, check for that particular file. If the file is found, then it has to load the data into my table. Okay, so it is the activity of a developer. Is that okay?
Yeah, it's okay, but looks like the files are in a different format or different with a different extension, right?
And that is the reason why I'm loading into a different set of tables, right? Let's say, okay, to answer your question. Okay, let's say I have a particular file, which is a comma separated file. Okay, so what am I going to do? I'm going to load into one particular table. This entire data is going to get loaded into one of my table. Likewise, I have another file, which is a pipe delimited file. This is going to load into another table. I'm not going to load this data into a separate table. But when I'm constructing these two tables, what would I see? I would see that they are alike because this is my area. I have access to this particular area. But I don't have access to the source area, right? I don't have access to the source area. Source may send the data in any of their desired format. I will not be having access to that. But when I get the access, when I see that particular data, I can load them. For instance, I'll show you. Okay, let me open this. I'll show you how I can load the data. Just give a minute. I'm not creating a job here. I'm just trying to see, show you a particular activity, how I can load the data. But the jobs are configured differently. Okay. So let's say I'm trying to create a file. First, let me create a table. Okay, I have created this particular table. I'm just committing it. Okay, now I'm creating a file. So what are the columns that I have? I have EMP number, I have ename, I have job, I have salary. So 3484 Durga QA lead, right? Salary, yes, 25,000. Save as desktop. I'm saving this as emp.csv, employee.csv. CSV. Okay, I'm saving this. So this employee, this file has been saved in .csv format now. This is a .csv format for me. Okay, now what am I going to do? I'm going to load that particular data. Testing. Okay. Now you see, I have this particular data. So I could import that particular data into a table. Now let's say I'm trying to create another file, right, which is a .dat and pipe delimiter. EMP number, pipe, ename, pipe. Let's say here, I have the name coming as employee name, right, designation, all right, salary. Okay, now 1001 pipe delimited. Okay, likewise Durga Satish pipe delimited. Okay, QA manager pipe delimited 3500. Likewise 1002 pipe delimited. Okay, Pawan Kumar pipe delimited. All right, project manager. All right, so how am I saving this particular file? Save as, I'm saying this as employee underscore second dot dat. I'm saving this as dot dat file. Now I'm trying to import the data. Import, locate your file. What happened? File user input cannot be opened due to error null. Okay. I should be able to open it. One sec. Let me truncate this particular data. There might be some error. I'm not sure why I'm getting this particular error, but we can even load the pipe delimited one. Let's say okay, let me do it this way. This is done. What I'm trying to do is, I'm showing a different method to show you how it goes. those. What's this? I'm going to see where it's going. I can see the data, right? So what I'll do, save this as log. I'm saving in a different format. It's not able to read it. Saving it. Yes, delimiter. Now delimiter is my pipe. See, I'm able to load it. Right. Now here, I'm not going to go with the name. I'm going to go with the position. See, though my column names are different. Insert fail for rows 1 and 2. Large value, because I defined a great value, right? Okay, so let me say, okay, so it's minus tick again. Okay. Let's say PM. And QML. Okay, now I'll be able to load it. So what am I trying to do here is, I'm trying to load the data, right, in different formats, right? One is my CSV, the other one is, what is the other one? DSV. Okay, so though I have the file names different, and you see the column names is also different, what you are able to do? You are able to import them. Importing the actual 12, maximum 10. Okay. So where is this? Testing. Size difference. Let's see. Just give them an address. Sorry for the interruption. Okay, column. I'm changing the column names as well because this has function. Save.
Okay, cool. So the column names in the source file and also the table which you created should be the same, is it?
I don't think so, not required. Okay, it's again reading no, the same thing. Then. See, it's again reading the same old values. Let me clear it off. Import. No. Let me clear it off. No. Okay. It's actually reading the old values. Oh, sorry, man.
Durga, you are trying to extract the data from different sources to staging table, is it?
Sorry, I'm trying to.
You're trying to extract data from different sources into one staging table. Is my understanding correct?
Not into one single staging table. I'm trying to extract the data into different tables now. I'm not trying to load the data into one single staging table. Like, let's say here I have the hetero. What I would say is, I would say this to go into customer underscore hetero. Okay.
Okay.
If I have metro or met plus, I would say customer underscore met plus. I'm not storing them into one single thing here. I can even store them into one single by giving a different set of functions. I'm not saying though, I'm not creating a complexity here at the very first stage. I'm directly trying to say that I am trying to have the source data loaded into my individual tables so that I can classify them very clearly. Making sense?
Yeah. So which would help us in a better way to load the data into one table, right? Like,
yeah. So I'm trying to say the same thing here. If you see the earlier picture as well, here I'm trying to this. That is why I said here customer underscore Apollo, customer under transaction underscore Apollo, or MetPlus underscore Apollo. Likewise, this Metro. So I have individual tables here to say I'm getting the data loaded into individual tables, not into a single table. Even I can load the data into a single table, that would be a different set of approach, like I'm trying to do now. Okay, I have a bad set file created, it is trying to pull the data, same data from that particular bad file, for which I'm not able to load it here. Okay, so anyway, I'll show you this one as well, how this goes. But the thing is, whenever you have this old data coming from different sources, what you do, you place them into your staging area, into a temporary location. Okay, so once you place them into your temporary location, what happens here, you'll be having the data. I have classified the data into three different tables. You see these particular boxes, these three boxes are nothing but my three different tables for me. So into this I have the data loaded. Okay, so once this data is loaded, now I have to transform the data and load them into my customer underscore active table. So which is going to get the transformations as I have to join all these three tables. Okay, I have to join all these three tables. Now join in the sense I'll be making a union here. Okay, a union operation. I would be making a union operation here. On making the union operation, what happens? I have to filter out the records which would pull only active records. So when I see the records as active, now I have to enumerate them. Right, if I see active, then I have to make them A, and once making them as A, I have to load them into my customer underscore active table. Likewise, on unioning it, I have to figure out all inactive records. All right, so once inactive records are figured out, are filtered out, I have to enumerate into those values as I, then I have to load into another table called as customer underscore inactive. So what I'm trying to do here, I'm extracting the data, at the same time I'm transforming the data, and I'm loading the data. This is the place where I'm preserving the data. Okay, so extraction, transformation, and loading is happening here. So ETL is that. In the first place, we are talking about ETL, right? So what is ETL? ETL is a process of extracting the data, transforming the data, and loading the data into our warehousing system. Okay, so now you got this particular data. So what we are trying to say, we are trying to say that this is the month. Let's say we got the data for June month. Okay, now after August 1st, we'll get the data for July. Once I get the data for July, once I get these particular files, when these particular files are getting loaded into my staging, what happens? My previous data within my staging tables will be truncated. Okay, it will not be having the data permanently. My previous data within my staging tables will get truncated. And fresh data that is coming from the sources will get loaded into those particular tables. So that means I'm not trying to maintain the data within my staging area permanently. I'm maintaining this particular data on temporary basis, that too till that particular job gets executed, and by the time the next job runs, this data, the old data within the staging table should get truncated because the data already got loaded into my warehouse table. I'm not bothered about it again, right? I'll be only bothered about the new set of data that is going to come into picture, and as and when I see a new set of file that is coming in, that gets loaded into my staging table, erasing my old data. So here, staging is a database which maintains the data on temporary basis. It will not maintain the data permanently. Okay, so again the same process happens. So as and when you get the monthly files from each and every source, the data gets loaded into your staging area. From staging area, all your transformations are going to get applied. On applying all these particular transformations, the data will get loaded into our warehousing table. And this process goes on Okay. Now from the warehouse, the BI team will come into picture, the business intelligence. Now we are maintaining only the extracted and transformed data within your warehouse, right? All your warehouse tables. From this, the business intelligence team comes into picture. So what the business intelligence team does, they would analyze these particular tables, whatever the tables into which the data got loaded. They would analyze all these particular tables. They would create some views. On creating their views, what they would do, they would create a web reports. Right, they would create the web report, the reports that can be accessed online. So these are called as your business intelligence reports. You would see a pie graph, bar graph, just like you see your share market sites and everything. Okay, so they are nothing but our business intelligence reports. So what the management team does, they would look these particular reports to analyze the performance of a particular business, to analyze the data. So based on that particular analysis, they would take their decisions. This is how our warehouse system gets created and implemented, and this is how the decisions are taken out. Okay. Any questions so far? Any questions from anyone? Am I clear with this particular part?
This is Prem Prakash. Would you just mind to just repeat this part, this extraction, transformation, and this loading process?
Okay, let's do that. Okay, let's take
Yes. Also this
sorry
exactly I want to know the where the testers role comes.
I'm gonna come. I did not come into the testers roles actually. Okay, I'm just giving you a highlight. See, before actually testing something, we need to know why we are supposed to do the testing activity on it, right? So the main agenda of today is to give you an overview or insight about the warehousing, and I will then derive the important things as what are we supposed to test and how we are going to test the things. That would be the next part of the agenda. Okay. All right. So like you pointed, I'm trying to give you the explanation again in a different manner. Let's say this is my Apollo related data. This is my Hetero and this is my MetPlus. Okay. They are vending the data for the month of June. Okay. Now, I have to have a process which would extract the data from these particular sources. So what I would say, I would create an extraction process. I would ask my developers to create an extraction process which would pull the data from these particular sources, which would pull the data from these particular sources and loads them into my staging. This is my staging area. Okay, my staging area is my temporary database, okay, which holds the data for temporarily. Now, on extracting this particular data into my staging, so it will get loaded into the corresponding tables. If I get 10 number of files, if my business requires to create 10 number of tables in my staging, I would have all these particular files data getting loaded into all these particular staging tables. Okay, once the data is getting loaded in
here, the developer generally creates the number of tables which are required and then create a job to extract the data from that source to these tables, is correct?
Correct. Here the data modeler would create these particular tables, not the developers. Okay, the data, see, okay. All the tables creation would be done by your data modelers, the modeling team. You have a separate modeling team who would create all these particular tables. Okay, now once you have the tables, then your developers would come into picture. What they would do is they would create a job so that the file data gets loaded into that particular tables, or your Oracle system data gets loaded into that particular tables. Clear, Swami? Perfect. Now,
do they think how do they know that what are the required columns to be presented in that table?
Yeah.
Generally, do they check the source file first and then create the tables accordingly?
Okay, I'll come to that particular part, like what kind of a documentation we are going to refer in order to do that activity. It is the same documentation that we refer and also our development team refers. Based on that, they would do this particular activity.
Okay.
Okay, you have a documentation called as mapping, because I'm not giving all the terminologies right away. I don't want to confuse everyone directly. So you have a separate set of document called as mapping document, which would give you more information about what are the columns, what are the columns that you get from the source, and what are the columns that you will be having in your staging, what are the columns that you will be having in your warehouse. So this documentation will give you all that particular information. Based on that particular documentation, developers would create a workflow or create a job that moves the data from one place to another place. Okay, I'll talk in detail about this mapping document. Any other questions, Swami?
No. Yeah, this I got it out in between. Just wanted to know. I didn't know that you're going to cover mapping. So okay.
No. I'll definitely cover. See, this is what my promise is. If I start something, I will definitely deliver. Okay, incomplete. There will not be any part which I leave. Without touching it at all. Okay, I'll definitely give you that information.
And I wanted to ask you this, but I'm not sure whether it's related to our topic or not. Uh-huh. I understood developers and data modelers. I know about the developers because they are there in my team. But data modelers, I'm a little bit confusing. So if that's okay with you, so would you give, it is 1 to 2 points about that data modeling and modelers?
Sure, I'll give you. Possibly. I'll give you what data modeling team does and everything. Okay.
Sure,
I would show you a data model. Based on that, you will understand. What do I mean by data modeling, and what do they do and how they does their work? I'll give you in a pointer way. Okay.
Thank you so much.
Will that help, Swami?
That would really help me. Thanks a lot.
Sure, I'll give you that information. All right. Now I have these particular tables in my staging area. Right. So what I need to have a developer who pulls this particular data from the sources and loads this. So the developer would create a particular job. On creating this particular job, this is going to extract the data and store into these particular files. And then from here, the transformations are applied. I'm going to make the data according to my business requirement. So in order to make the data according to my business requirement, there comes my necessity in transforming the data, changing the data according to my business perspective, giving a new shape to the data. That is what I mean by transformation. So from staging, before loading the data into your warehouse, so what we do? We do the transformation. We do the necessary transformation so that I'll be able to load the data into my corresponding warehouse. So the necessary transformation is, like I was trying to say, if I see the active customers, then I would have the status shown as active. If I see the inactive customers, I have to see the status as I. All right. So this is how I'm transforming the data. I'm just giving a new shape to the data. Okay, on giving this new shape to the data, what am I trying to do? I'm preserving the data. So where am I preserving the data? In the tables of my warehouse. these are my sources. Okay, these are my sources and this is my target. So within the target, I'm preserving my data in the tables according to my business requirement. According to my business requirement. So once this is done, once I have all set of data here, which is then pulled by the BI team, the business intelligence team, which they project onto our web reports, the UI reports. You can access them over online. Okay, so like you will be having reports like your, if you have seen these reports or not, the share market reports, okay, the trendy reports that you see. So you'd see reports of such kind. So what managers does, because managers needs everything in a conclusive manner, everything in a summarized way. So these reports would give you that kind of information. Now managers would look at these particular reports and they access the things, like they would see how the things are happening. Now this is all about your June month data. Now I have the July month data coming in. I got the July month data. So when I get the July month data in all the three files, now before I load the data into my staging, what happens? The old data that I have within my staging tables, what is the old data that I have here? I have the June related data, right? I have the June related data in my staging tables. So before July data loaded or is getting loaded into this particular tables, it would truncate this June related data, making the tables empty, and it will load only July related data into that particular tables. On loading this particular July related data, again the same transformations would be initiated on that particular data. Again the data gets loaded into my warehouse table. The same data is going to get picked up by the BI team where they show the reports. Is that clear? This is how the ETL mechanism happens. Clear?
Durga, this staging table is just like a temporary table. Only
right.
The data being removed or truncated every time as per our requirement.
Perfect. Every time whenever you get a new set of load, the data within the staging gets truncated. It's not getting dropped, but it's getting truncated.
Okay.
Clear, Prem?
Yes.
All right. So any other questions from anyone before I move forward? Okay, I take your silences as no, then I'm moving forward. All right. Fine. So this is how our general mechanism within the ETL projects would happen. Okay, you have your sources defined, you have your targets defined, and based on your requirement, you're going to get the data extracted, transformed, and loaded into your warehousing system. Now, as an ETL testing activity, what would be our duties here? What should be our duties? Like I was trying to figure out, I am saying that I'm getting the source data in the form of files. So what we have to ensure? We have to ensure that the files are according to the requirements. So what do I mean by according to the requirements? Let's say I have a file and the file name as EMP_monthly. Okay, let me talk in the medical term. customer_mmyyy.csv. The file name should be as in this way. This is what the Apollo is vending. Okay, this is what Apollo is vending. Apollo will send a file of customer in this particular format. And the job will pick a file if at all it is in this particular format, customer_mmyyy. If at all the file is in this particular format, only then the job has to pull. The job should not pull any other irrelevant file. Let's say I have a file made with mmyyy format. Now, if this is the file that is seen in your FTP location, this file should not be pulled. Okay, it has to pull the file if at all it is in this particular shape. So that means I have to have a file like in this way, customer_06 2015.csv. If I see a file of this nature, then I should, the job should pull that particular file. So this would be your basic check as what you're going to do as part of your files. Okay, later on. Okay, now you may get the file with huge set of records, you may get the file with few set of records. But what we have to do in order to test, what we are supposed to do, we have to test with each and everything. We have to test with an empty set of file. Okay, I have the filing naming convention as this way, customer_062015.csv. So what would I say? I would maintain a file which is of empty. So what is the job doing? How is the job handling this particular empty set of file? Will it load any kind of invalid data into the tables or not? That is what you have to check. Okay, then you have to go with the valid records. Right, you have to go with invalid records. So what do I mean by invalid records? Let's say my customer file has got these particular data, customer name, enrolled on, all right, status. Let's say I have these particular things. Now the data, valid data, says that my, according to my requirements, the valid data would be customer ID should be in numerical or number format. Okay, the customer ID has to be in number format and the maximum size that is allowed is 5. Okay, and likewise customer name.
I don't know if I can answer that properly. I can do.
Sorry. Customer name, it has to be the maximum size of 25 and it has to be only characters. No special characters and numbers are allowed. Likewise, I have enrolled on. This particular field is a date field, all right, and the date format is in this way. It has to have the date format in this way, MMDDYYYY. Okay, this is the date format. Likewise, I have the status. Status should be 8 in length, all right. It should hold, the valid status that it can hold is active, inactive, or empty set of data, not defined. If you see any data over there, it is an invalid record. Okay, let's say these are my different, for these are my standards, my file standards, the data that the file should contain. So what are we going to do? We are going to create a separate test files. Now always when testing with the ETL functionality, so what are we supposed to do? We are supposed to test the, we are supposed to test with more set of your negative data to ensure that no invalid data gets loaded into our file. So what we are going to do, we are going to prepare our test data. So I'm going to prepare my table, my file as 062015.csv, in which I'll have the data in this way, cust ID, cust name, enrolled on, status. These are the fields that I have. So the cust ID that I'm giving is 1101. I'm meeting the criteria of 5 in length. Next, characters. Okay, Durga Satish. I'm meeting the, length again. Enrolled on, let's say, 2015. Okay, and status active. This is my valid record. I'm good with this. When I execute this particular job, this record has to be moved onto my tables. There should not be any problem. Okay. Likewise, I'm trying to create another record. Is this a valid data for customer ID? Will this be a valid data for my customer ID? This will not be a valid data. Why this will not be a valid data? You see this. The customer ID should be in number format. But what kind of a data I'm passing here? I'm passing the character data. So will this be a valid format? The answer is no. It's not a valid format. So what should happen when I create a file with the invalid set of data? What should happen? This particular record should not reach my target table. Okay, it has to be rejected. Likewise, what would I do? I would create the test data in a different format. Let's say the enrolled on. So what is the date format here? MMDD YYY. I give the date as in this way, 21-06-2015. Will this be a valid format again? No, this is not a valid format. So what am I trying to do here? What I'm trying to say is, my initial testing would start with the file. Okay, I would check the naming standard of the file. Okay, I would see, I would test first, I would load the data with empty set of file. Okay, and see whether any of the target tables are getting affected with this particular empty set of file. Then what would I do? I would create a file with all valid records and see how the target tables are getting affected. Then what would I say? I would create a file with invalid records. Okay, and see how the target tables are affected. So at any point of time, my way or my, testing approach would be to ensure that I have only valid records that are getting loaded into my target tables. This is what my agenda, or this is what my core goal is, or main goal is. I have to ensure that only valid records are getting loaded into my target table. All the invalid records that are coming as part of your source has to get rejected or has to be moved into any of the other tables, other exception tables or your error tables. Okay, so our ETL testing responsibilities, like you asked. So what will be our ETL testing responsibilities? Our data is moving from file to staging and staging to target tables. So what we have to ensure? We have to ensure that in any of these three forms, like from file to staging, whatever the file data that you have, the data has to be loaded into your staging. Let's say in the file I'm getting 10 records. All the 10 records needs to be in my staging table now. Okay, now from staging, the data has to be loaded in into the target tables on applying all the transformation rules. Right, on applying all the transformation rules. Now here, we have to test it, right? Now if it is 10 records, I can do it manually. I can check, okay, whether they are getting updated or not. But in a file, from the source, you may get the data into 10,000s or lakhs or millions of records, all right? In that case, you cannot directly have an eye check done. So what needs to be done? You have to make use of your SQL queries again. Right, so what you do? Right, file is a non-relational RDBMS and your staging is a RDBMS tables. So what we do? We load this particular file into a temporary table. Okay, then we'll make use of our temporary table against this particular staging table. Then what we write? We write a query as temporary minus staging union staging minus temporary. So why am I trying to do this particular way approach? This particular approach will give me whether the data that you have loaded into your staging table is in the proper shape or not, is the same data that you are coming that you're getting as part of your file or not. This is what you do. All right, so once this is done, now what you do? You have to test from staging to target whether the data from your staging has been properly transformed and loaded onto your target tables or not. So what are you supposed to do? You are supposed to write another SQL. Now, this SQL will include the transformation rule. Now, what is the SQL that we are going to write? Here, earlier we have discussed that we are getting three different files, right? Three different files from three different sources. Now, all the data is going to get loaded here. But we have to have the customer related data loaded here. And how the customer related data should be loaded? It has to be union of all these three. So what we write? We write a query, union query, which is going to pull the data from all the three tables. On top of this union query, we'll create a select statement. And within the select statement, what we do? We create a case statement. Within the case, we say, if data is active or if status is active, then A. If status is inactive, then I. All right. else, I mean else in the, oh no, we have to check for only null. If it is empty, then say it as null or whatever it is. Okay, end. And I'll filter this particular data. I'll pass only active related customers into my customer underscore active table. I'll check my inactive into customer underscore inactive. So what am I trying to do here? I'm preparing a SQL to test whether the staging data is as, I mean, whether the target data is as per my staging data, incoming staging data. So with this SQL, what I do, I'll say my staging SQL, which is having all my transformation rules, minus my target table, original target table, which is loaded by the developer's job, union, target table, minus sources, I mean staging SQL. So this would give me a confidence over this particular job. If at all I don't see any records as an output, it means that all the records are valid records and they have been loaded properly from your staging tables. This is how our testing would be initiated. Is that okay? Clear, guys? What are we supposed to do? No worries. I mean, this is a rough or a sketch explanation. I have created certain mapping, certain jobs for us where we are going to test it practically. But this is an outline as what we are supposed to do. Is this clear? Or at least have you got an idea of what are we supposed to do?
Yeah, it's clear. Oh, Durga, I mean.
Okay. So whatever we are seeing here, I'm going to show you in the form of an example and I'll try to make you understand. I'll try to show you a different set of approaches as what are we supposed to do and how we have to test it. Okay. All right. Fine. So the next thing. So this is what our tester's responsibility is. But in order to start testing the things, we should know few concepts of data warehouse. We have to know few concepts of our data warehouse. To initiate testing activities on a data warehouse application or a data warehouse, what we need to know? We need to know few concepts. The concepts like the tables we will be having in data warehouse. What are the different kinds of tables that we see in data warehouse? Now, after this, the schemas that we have in warehouse. Okay, and likewise we have the architectures, different architectures of data warehouse. Okay, likewise types of classifications of tables again. Okay, so we'll see all these things. Now, the first thing is tables we'll be having in warehouse. There are mainly two tables in warehouse. They are our dimension tables and fact tables. These are the two different kinds of tables that we'll be having within our warehouse. So what is dimension tables and what is fact tables? Okay. Now I'm trying to give you a table structure. Based on that, we'll understand what it is. Okay. So I'm trying to create a sales table. And the sales table has got these as the records. Sale ID. Every sale is represented by a sale ID. And this is my primary key. Okay. Likewise, CUST ID. The customer who has performed this particular sale. EMP ID, the employee who has assisted this particular customer in performing this particular sale. Prod ID, the product that the customer has purchased by the assistance of this particular employee. Cost of that particular product, right? Quantity purchased by the customer. This is my table structure. Okay, and I have the data in this way. Let's say the sale ID is 1234. The customer ID is 1001. The employee ID is 9001. Okay. The prod ID is A54. The cost is $250. And the quantity is 10. Likewise, another sale has been performed, 1235, by another customer. Same employee who has assisted him. The product is same, different, I89. Okay. The cost is $59 and he has purchased 3 in quantity. Now, what is this particular table giving you? What kind of information the table is holding? What kind of information this table is holding? Looking at the table, what is the information that you can get out of this particular table?
Actually, we are getting the information like sale ID, customer ID, employee ID.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, information, I mean to say information about all this sales, customer, employee.
Any other information that you can get from this?
So basically, we have like how many items we have sold and kind of the who sold, this is what I can say.
Yeah. So that means you said it correctly, but I'm trying to come to the nearest point. I can say I see the transactions happening within this table. Can I say that?
No.
Can't I say that there is a transaction happened? I can see the transaction related data. Now let's say you went to your store, you swiped your card. What do you get? You get a slip within that, the payment slip. Within that payment slip, you see the transaction ID and as well as you see all the amounts and the prices and whole at the end, you see the amount, right? Same is the case here. Okay, the sale ID, every sale that is being performed, you'll be having an ID represented. But you see these things, these are the qualifying fields for this particular sale ID. But what is the sale that has happened? 250 into 10, $2,500 was the sale transaction happened. Aren't you getting this information from this table? Are we getting this information or not?
Yeah, we are getting.
Right. Likewise, yes. 59 into 3. Again, I'm getting another transaction. It is showing another transaction that has happened. Right. Likewise, this entire table, what this entire table will say? This entire table will show me will be based on these two columns like cost and quantity. They are my business transactional related columns, BTD. Business transactional related data is maintained within these two columns. And this sales table is giving me whole set of my transactional information. Under table which gives you the transactional information is nothing but your fact table. So a fact table or a table which gives us the transactional related information is a fact. Is that clear? A table in which you see transactions happening is nothing but a fact.
So here, like this is 250 and the 10, this is basically a the information, transaction related information, correct?
Perfect. Instead of this, had I given you an amount directly?
Yes, correct. This makes more clear than.
Okay, see, those are your qualifying columns. Like let's say, if I say amount, what is this particular amount? What is the quantity that is sold? You're missing those particular measurable things. Making sense? So if I say directly an amount, I'll be missing an important concept called or important idea called as the quantity of items that I have sold. But I need to even have that particular measurement done. Clear, Prem?
Yes, it is.
So that is why I said instead of amount, I'm just maintaining as cost and quantity. Now, this would be useful for my analysis. How many products were sold? So based on this particular quantity factor, I can give that particular information for myself, right? So 250 and 10, let me say 59 and 3. So these two columns together will signify my transaction. But what is this particular fields? Customer ID, employee ID. Who is this 1001? Who is this 9001? What is this A54? Do I have any information here related to 1001? If I have to know the information of 1001, Where should I go?
You have to go another table. If you have to find this 1001.
I have to go to the customer table. Right. So I said 1001 is nothing but a customer ID. So where will I have that particular customer ID? I'll be having the cust ID, the cust name, I mean the customer name, the city, state, phone number, email ID, blah, 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 blah stuff. Okay. So what is this here? This is my primary key. Let's say every customer needs to be identified by unique ID. So here, what is it? If I talk about, if I want to know who is 1001, okay, 1001 is Mr. Durga. He stays in Hyderabad. He belongs to Telangana, right? His phone number is so-and-so and his email ID is so-and-so. So my information related to 1001 is stored in a table called as customer, and where you have the entire information, the master information of that 1001. So a table, this customer table, so what kind of a data it is storing? This table is storing the master data, right? So under table which stores the master information is nothing but your dimension tables. A table in which you have the master information stored is nothing but your dimension tables. A table in which you see the transactions happening is nothing but your fact tables. These are the two different kinds of tables that you would see in case of your warehouse. Is that clear? So what is a dimension table? A dimension table is a table which contains the master information or a detailed information. Now earlier I was pointing to only 1001, but I will be getting to know the detailed information if I refer to that particular dimension table. Right, I'll be getting to know the information about 1002 when I refer to the dimension table of customer. Likewise, employee table. If I refer to the employee table, I'll be able to figure out who is that particular employee ID, what is his name, what is his designation, what is his salary, and blah, blah, whatever the fields that I have. So I'll be having the entire master information stored in the employee table. Likewise, the product table. Right, so what is the product ID for? Right, product ID would stand as my primary key. What is the product name? Right, who is the make of this particular product? When was the product came into the store? Right, and so on. Whatever the information that we maintain here. So what am I going to get here in the customer table or in the employee table or in the product table? What kind of a data I'm trying to maintain? I'm trying to maintain the data that is purely related to that particular table itself. Okay, so when I talk about Durga, who is Durga? Durga is a customer, right? Who is a particular employee called as Satish? He is a particular employee and he will be identified by 9001, right? You have the master set of information maintained in your dimension tables, whereas your fact tables will have only the transactional information. Now, how are these dimensions and facts are related? The dimensions and facts are related through primary and a foreign key relationship. Right. Dimensions and facts are related through primary and foreign key relationship. Right, they are related through the primary and a foreign key relationships. Okay, so now based on these particular relationships, you have two different schemas. Now schemas is nothing but the way the objects are created. Okay, the way the objects are created. So when I say the objects, it can be your tables or views or your procedures, functions, whatever it is. If I show this, all right, these are nothing but my objects within my Scott schema, my tables within my Scott schema. Now every table has got a relation. Now department is my primary table, which has got a relation to the employee table, which has got a relation to the sal grade table, which has got a relation to the bonus table. So they are in relation. Okay. Now likewise, within your warehouse, you have two different schemas. One is your star schema. The other one is your snowflake star schema. So what is star schema here? A star schema says that a fact table surrounded by different dimension tables. So what does it mean? It means that in this way. Like let's say this is my sales table. Alright, this is my different tables. Let's say this is my customer table. This is my product table. This is my employee table. Okay, now this becomes a star problem. It is not necessary that I should have only three tables. Okay, so what kind of a table is sales? Sales will be my fact table. What kind of a table will be my customer? It would be a dimension table. Product is a dimension table. Employee is a dimension table. So all these are my dimension tables and sales is my fact table. Okay? Right. So this kind of arrangement is called as your star schema. A fact table surrounded by different dimension tables is nothing but my star schema. Okay. Likewise, I have a snowflake star schema. So what does it say? It say that a fact table surrounded by different dimension tables, and these dimension tables have references to the master dimension tables. Another dimension.
We can't really see your screen now.
Oh, is it?
Yes.
You able to see now?
Not yet.
Oh, what is happening?
Seems that Nagaraja has left actually, it looks like.
Okay, I'm the presenter, right?
Okay, I'm not sure. Just I was saying, I'm not sure. Still, we cannot see your screen.
One sec. Okay. Okay, just give me a minute. Okay, one sec. Let me join again. Please, you people join again. Okay. I'm disconnecting now. I'll rejoin again so that you can see the things. Fine.
So do you want us also join again?
Yeah. You'll be joined again, okay?